So, hi, I'm Pete. I'm at Peter J. West on Twitter, and we're going to be talking about TypeScript theory, some practical steps to get started, and some of the stuff that they don't tell you about, or it's kind of like a bit hidden, so that if you do want to get started, it's less horrible. So hopefully this talk's going to be, I think of TypeScript as kind of like a slightly dumber version. It's not as clever as pure script, but it's got some nice, cool stuff you can do. So, TypeScript is a language that adds strong typing on top of JavaScript, and it compiles back down to JavaScript. So if you've heard of Flow, it's a similar kind of concept. It complements the open, malleable design principles of JavaScript, which is basically, it's flexible, powerful, and you can massively abuse it like JavaScript. So if you like that feature of JavaScript, then it's something you're going to get more of. So it's got kind of a steep learning curve, probably not as steep as pure script, but it's got some nice benefits to code quality once you actually get it working and integrated and you really get your kind of type support up. The other thing I'd say for that is that once you've got it set up, it's not a lot of overhead over developing in JavaScript. It's actually fairly similar. So the other thing that people don't necessarily notice with TypeScript straight away is that it's got basically no overhead, no impact on your ultimate JavaScript, because it essentially compiles all of that out. So the compiler is really simple. It does two things. It checks your code is correct using the type information you've provided, kind of like a supercharged linter, and then it just removes all the types. So what you end up with is if you just had not written any of the types. So why might you care about types? Types will give you improved robustness. They will catch bugs before they happen. They will let you know when you've written trivial typos. Some of the stuff that PureScript offers, but PureScript will do that much better. But it's still pretty good. And one of the other things I didn't realize when I started this is it kind of gives you this accurate self-documenting code. It's not perfect, but if you've written a lot of doc blocks, I hate doc blocks because a doc block is always out of date. If you go and make a cup of tea and you come back, the doc block is now out of date. Having that embedded in the functions means that it's always up to date, and if it doesn't match, if it doesn't make sense, then your code just won't compile. So that's quite nice. And the final thing is that I found that it kind of improves your understanding of what you're coding. Like, previous to this, I would sort of have this fuzzy idea of, oh, I've got this array of like object-y things and they've got some properties, but they might be used across multiple files and you'll forget about a certain property, and it basically ends up being sort of like a mess in your head. And if you're forced to explicitly write that out, you can go back and check it always has to be consistent, and you mean is that across files it's kind of always going to make sense. Kind of ties your code together in a consistent way. So looking at a basic example, so this is your JavaScript with some nice ES6 for loopy thing. So we've got like counting letters. We've got some words, which words have to be an array, and then we're checking the length of them. So I guess it's an array of strings, and then count's going to be a number. So we're going to just sum up. So we're just summing up how many letters are in an array of strings. And the TypeScript equivalent of this is this. So this is one TypeScript equivalent. So this is now actually fully typed. So TypeScript knows exactly what's going on in terms of types in the whole function. And that's because of a big feature in TypeScript called type inference. So what's actually happening is TypeScript knows that count is a number type because it's been initialized with a number. It knows that word is a string because it's been iterated from words, which is an array of strings. And it knows that strings have a length property, which is a number, so those can be added to count. And finally, it knows the return type of this whole function is going to be a number because we're returning count. So it's basically looking at the structure of the code and figuring out what all of the things are. And because it can do that, it doesn't mind. So it's basically kind of, the fact there's no red lines here means that TypeScript is completely happy with what's going on. And we don't have to rely on type inference, so we can, oh yeah, I'll also show you. So this is, if you're using something like VS Code or an IDE, this is the tooltip you get if you hover over count letters, so you can see that it's got the return type there, which is number. We don't have to be implicit about this, we can be explicit. So this is the same function fully typed, so this is everything we can type, we can specify. So we've said we definitely want a number back. And this now means if I accidentally delete the return count statement, then it will complain. And we've also explicitly typed the number, so if someone was to actually accidentally change that to a letter, things wouldn't go crazy. So you can be more explicit. There's a bit of a question as to how much we should use type inference. So it's kind of a hotly debated topic in some typed languages as to whether this is a good thing or not to rely on this cool cool feature. I clearly like it. So with type inference, you get more concise code. You don't have to write as much. Some people think it looks nicer, but the downside is it's less explicit. So if you're just looking on GitHub, you don't necessarily know all the things, and you have this reliance on your IDE to tell you stuff if it's not obvious. So there's sort of potential drawbacks for this. I think it's kind of up to you to decide. Personally, my team at work use this. We use VS Code pretty much exclusively, and we use code type inference a lot because it's awesome and TypeScript does it really nicely. Anyway, I'll leave that up to you. So, some fundamental types. So I haven't explained the syntax yet, but basically to put a type on a variable, you put a colon and then the type before the assignment. And if you're not doing the assignment, you don't put that there. But these are kind of the primitive types you get. So we've already seen number and string. You get Boolean, null and undefined are explicit types. Anything with square brackets on the end is an array, and you can have an array of anything. So I could have an array of nulls if I want. But that's how you specify that. And then we've got the slightly more complicated ones, so dictionaries and objects. So in JavaScript, your objects are kind of like a big bucket, and you can just put anything you want in it at any time, and there's no rules, and nothing matters. And we often think of it in that way, as just it's a container for stuff. But TypeScript draws this distinction between the bucket thing, which you call a dictionary, and an object, which is a specific set of keys with specific values. So we have the D variable here, which is going to be a dictionary, and we basically say the key, any key, will be a string, which is kind of what it always has to be, and the value will be a number. So as long as you put numbers in the values of this, it's happy, it doesn't mind. And you can put any key, it doesn't care. With the object as the second one, it was said that A has to be a number, B has to be a string. So you have to put those two in, and you can't miss them out. So if I were to change either of those to violate those rules, then we'll get an error. So we'll have a look a bit more about objects in a second, but I just wanna touch on some evil types. They're not that evil, but they're a bit evil. So number, string, and Boolean. So if we look at the previous slide, they're lowercase. Lowercase is good, that's the type. Uppercase is the object constructors, which you should never use in JavaScript because they're really old and bad and things go wrong. So unless you're using those, you should use the lowercase primitives. I've tested it and it seems to work fine, but it's kind of wrong. What's worse is object. So object basically means any object that inherits from the base object class, which is any object. it's not wrong, it's just completely useless unless you want to check that something is an object rather than isn't an object. And function is kind of the same, but for function, so any function is a function type, but there are better types you can use to define those, and we'll kind of see some of those later. So these are sort of evil, but not too bad. TypeScript provides some ways to kind of reuse types and share them across modules. And it's got kind of two constructs for doing that. Interfaces. So if you've done any types in other languages, it's pretty similar, but done in a kind of JavaScript-y way. So this is defining an interface foo. So essentially, we're going to say an object that has a name that's a string, and we can then assign that type to our foo object. And as long as it matches, then everything's good. We can also do bar, which is we can also do type, which is a type statement that it's more like a kind of assignment, like if you're just assigning variables, way of defining types. So bar equals this thing. And to all intents and purposes, for this example, there's like no difference in defining them either way. You can define foo as a type and bar as an interface, and it makes zero difference to anything that's happening here. There are some differences we'll get into in a second, but for simple examples, there's really no difference between them, and there's no particular reason to use either one. It's kind of stylistic. Interfaces. Interfaces, as I said, are kind of like classes, so you can do similar things. So you can extend a class, extend an interface. So child is extending base, so child is going to have a name as well as the set name method. The other thing you can do with interfaces is you can classes can implement them, which basically just means TypeScript will check that your class does what the interface says. So if we implemented child in a class, then it would require that that class had a name string and set name. And these are really useful if you want to be able to kind of use your classes in interoperable places and pass them into utility functions and have them all have the same common base so they can be used. So type statements. You can't do inheritance, but you can do things you can't do in interfaces. So you can alias stuff. So child, I just alias that to base. And you can do a kind of a whole lot more stuff, which we're about to have a look at. Unions. Unions are basically OR for types. You can see the single pipe character there. So we can basically say that a type, we're going to call it character list. So a character list is kind of a string, list of characters, but also you can think of that as a array of numbers. So we could say these things are kind of similar, so let's put them in a type. And then if I wanted to have a function, my function can truncate some text, but the text is either going to be a string or going to be a list of numbers. And in this case, TypeScript knows that both of these things have a length. So it's fine to have if text.length is greater than limit, because they both have a length, and the length, both of them have a length that's a number. However, when we get inside that if statement, text.substr, that doesn't hold true for an array of numbers. So substr is a string method, doesn't work on an array. So this doesn't work, and TypeScript knows it. However, we can just use slice, which will do the same thing. Pretty sure, didn't test it thoroughly, but I think that's the same thing. We can use slice here, and slice kind of has the same effect in this case on numbers and on strings. So everything's fine, and we can truncate our text. And we don't actually need the if at all. I think it would just work anyway, but it illustrates my point. If we've got these unions, then it's kind of awkward because we can't ever use the string method on a string or the number method on a number. But we can, because TypeScript is really clever. So in this function, we've got a value, I've called it value type, it's a terrible name, and it's a string or a number. And TypeScript is aware of type checks. So it knows that when we say if type of value is number, it knows that inside that block, that thing must be a number. So if you actually hover over that value, I did a slide for it, but if you hover over that value, it will say, this is definitely a number. So that means that it's completely fine with us doing value.tofixed. So this lets us do similar kind of pattern matching that we were seeing in PureScript, where we can have types of different things and we have to deal with them all. Because if we try and return something that's not a string here, then it's going to complain. It would be better if I'd put the return type on the function. Oh yeah, I didn't actually say properly, but the return type on the function goes in colon after the arguments. If I put the return type on the function, then we would have some guarantees, and TypeScript would shout at us if we didn't return the right types. So you can get some of the same kind of guarantees as PureScript, but they're not quite as strong. So intersections. This is like the sibling operator to OR. So OR is like distinct different types that we're saying can be this or that or that. AND is basically saying we want to smush them together. So we've got foo, we've got bar, one's got a name, one's got an age. Foo and bar is just an object which has a name and an age. And as long as they don't clash, as long as they don't have anything that conflicts and overrides the other thing, then it's fine. If we had name string and name number, then it's going to be like, no, you can't do that. So I said we couldn't have inheritance in type statements, but this is actually kind of the same as doing an interface which extends two things. There's no difference. And one of the things is that anything that is object-like as a type is still a valid interface. So this type foo bar, that's still an interface. It's a type and it's an interface, that's all fine. So you don't have to use the term interface to make an interface, you just have to have something that makes sense as an interface. So another feature, object properties and function arguments can be optional. So basically means you can, functions, you can not provide an argument and it will default to undefined. And in an interface, you can not set that property and it will be undefined because it's not defined yet, and that's fine. It basically means you can have things that may or may not exist. So we can call slice with one argument and it will do the right thing, presuming we've coded in that case. And we can create a dog without a bone, and that's okay. But you can also give the bone to the dog later on and also take it away again afterwards. So this is we haven't got the cats yet. The cats are going to go, yeah. Null versus undefined. There was an article I read about not using null, but I couldn't find it. But I'm basically going to go with it's generally simpler to use undefined over null. There's nothing wrong with null in particular, but undefined basically like occurs naturally in JavaScript a lot, and when you use TypeScript you become painfully aware of how often it's there. So if you want to use null, you're going to have to be putting like this or null or undefined and doing this all the time, whereas if you just use undefined, things are just a bit smoother. So that's just an advisory, but it's not a very strong one. Yes, so this is my favorite feature in TypeScript, and I'm sure PureScript has got this. This is like a mainstay of typed languages. Basically, everything we've looked at so far has been for a particular type. So like we take an array of strings and we do stuff with it. Generics is a feature that lets you do that without specifying particular things. You could just take an array of something, but at the other end of that function, you get back that thing again with the types. And this is kind of important. It may be hard to sort of explain properly, but I'll give you some examples. So we've already seen, oh, we've got cats already. We've already seen arrays. So the cat square brackets, that's how we do arrays. But this is actually just a sort of syntactic sugar. So we don't need, that's a syntactic sugar. The sort of standard way is array square brackets cat. And you can think of a generic type being like a type that contains another type. So in the same way an array contains a bunch of stuff, array cat is saying, we're going to only have cats in this array. And that's something that TypeScript does more strictly than JavaScript, is it kind of expects arrays to just have one type of thing. I mean, you can obviously still use unions, but unions generally make your code more complicated. So if you can have an array of one type of thing, that's generally better. So cat is being used as the argument, as the type argument to the array type. So we're saying that's how we're defining what we're going to use. And we also get this with promises. So if anyone's familiar with these, then a promise has the argument to a promise type is the value that will get returned when it resolves. So this means we can have nice types on functions that are returning promises and doing stuff like that. So it works nicely with promises as well. It's got to the point where like these slides are just a complete surprise to me, because I have no concept of time or space. So here's an example for generic functions. So what we've got here is the square brackets again with type, and type is just a variable, it's a type variable I made up, so I'm just calling it type. It doesn't come from anywhere, it doesn't exist. And we're saying we're expecting to get an array of these things, and then one of these things. And so this function is here to basically just filter out all the things that are equal to the thing I'm searching for. Which is kind of pointless in a way, because if they're all equal, then all you get back is the number of things in the array. But it's a contrived example again. So we basically have like our, think of it like another argument, another set of arguments to your function. Is type is an argument, but it's a type argument. So if we want to use this, then we say, okay, filter value, we tell it what type it's expecting, so number, and then we give it an array and we give it a value. And so that's going to return back, when we run it as JavaScript, it's going to return back just an array with three in it because everything else didn't match. But my very favorite part with TypeScript is you don't need to do that, because TypeScript is actually really good at figuring out what that type should be. So it kind of looks at this function call and it goes, well, giving an array of strings and a string, and I know that this has to be an array of something and that has to be the same something, so I guess it's a string. This feature actually works incredibly well and in much more advanced like situations, and it means that we just write this without the type, without the generic type, and we call it a concrete type, and filter two will have the correct type. It will be, it will know it's an array of strings. So it's super neat. You don't need to know about it. I just really wanted to explain it because I like it a lot. So the other thing before we can kind of get into the getting started with it is third-party modules and like JavaScript. So there's a lot of JavaScript in the world, and we probably want to use it. Like if we could only use TypeScript in TypeScript, then that would make us very sad and we couldn't really do anything. Like I work in React, and if I could only use TypeScript, I couldn't use React, so I have to just like re-implement it. So TypeScript lets you import JavaScript libraries, but you need to separately tell it where the declaration files are to kind of explain what the type should be. So it's got the code, but you need to say, actually, the type here is this and this and this. And quite a few modules you'll find have them linked in the repository, so you just npm install and it works magically. And the rest, well, not the rest, but about another third of those have separate packages through app types. So if I wanted to install Bluebird, then I install Bluebird, and then I install app types Bluebird. And that will kind of separately install this other package that contains all the type information so you can use it. And a nice thing is you can write one of these definitions if there isn't one. You can also hack around it, which I'll show you, which is much easier. But if someone hasn't written their library friendly for TypeScript, you can make the types to make it friendly for TypeScript, which is nice. So as I've said in the slide, these types don't always exist, so sometimes you'll be left with no types for a particular package, which means that TypeScript doesn't really know what's going on with those. So getting started with using TypeScript. So that was all theory. I'm sure a lot of that went kind of and we went a bit too quick and a bit too in-depth for some people, but you don't need to know all of that now, because we're going to go with what you actually need to do to get using TypeScript, and you don't need to know about these. You don't need to know, like, this stuff is all stuff you can learn down the line. You can use TypeScript by following this sort of set of steps. So, you need to install TypeScript. Installing globally is great for hacking around, but for production, I would recommend installing it as a local one so you can lock the version. Create a tsconfig file. So this file will control some compiler settings and also control where it's going to look for files to compile. It's like most settings files. It's not that complicated. I'll go through the confusing bits in a minute. And you want to install any packages you've got installed. Install the app type slash thingy. Rename all your files to .ts. Or if you're using React, also .tsx. Actually, no, if you're using React, then this is not a sufficient guide. So I had a bit which I took out, which was crossing out one of the lines and replacing it with spend 5 to 10 hours configuring Webpack, because it is slightly bold, but it's not too bad. And there's loads of tutorials for that bit, so you can get through that bit. So rename all your files, and then basically you run the tsc command, which is the TypeScript binary, and it will. If it's in the right folder with the tsconfig, it's going to try and compile everything. And when it compiles everything, it's basically going to take all your TypeScript files and return all your JavaScript files. So you can easily go and look at all the code it's produced. However, there's a little hiccup here, which is when you try and compile it, having ported it from JavaScript, it's going to fail. So you're going to have to go through a bit of a cycle of like fixing and compiling and fixing and compiling. If you've got an editor like VS Code or another one that's got an IntelliSense integration, it's going to give you all the errors in line, which is really nice and convenient, so you can just see all the errors there. But yeah, that's kind of the slog for getting started. But once it's compiling, then you're golden, and then you can really start seeing benefits from TypeScript in terms of it catching things for you and making things easier. TSConfig essentials. I'm just going to go through like the four most confusing and important bits of the TSConfig file. A lot of them are really easy, like files. It's the list of files you want to compile. Exclude. It's the things you don't want to include. So these are ones that kind of really confuse me and also don't really make a lot of sense unless you know TypeScript. So module. Module is the module system that it uses when it's outputting the JS. So if you think like standard node imports or ES6 node imports and exports, this is what you're deciding. Generally, you can just leave it as common JS if you're not sure, and you'll get something that should run in node. Module resolution. Never change this. This is only exists because they implemented it wrong initially and had to make it backwards compatible, so it should be node. Doesn't matter what platform you're building for, it's node. Target. Target is the version of JavaScript you're targeting when you want to compile to. However, it's not doing what you think. It's not going to build to that version like Babel or like Rollup. It's not going to do nice things. It's just going to change like some stuff like arrow functions and destructuring and like syntactic features. It's going to downgrade those. It won't do any polyfilling. So if you're writing in ES6 and targeting ES5, it's not going to work. So if you want to run this in the browser, you still need to use something like Babel to polyfill down from there. This is kind of weird, and I've only just realized this, that our website doesn't properly polyfill down to the ES5. So that's fun. Lib is kind of similar. So this is basically adding types for different feature sets in JavaScript. So do you want access to the DOM? Do you want ES6? It's got like all the ESs, like there's so many. And yeah, you can put them all in. And what it means is that TypeScript will allow you to use them, but it's assuming that the ultimate JS will have them. So it's not going to polyfill those again. So you can't just run this on IE8, it won't work. You could probably run ES6 and DOM on latest Chrome, but if you want support for other browsers and want to go back to ES5 again, you're going to need Babel to do that. Right, so I'm going to go through like a couple of like common problems that you'll get that aren't necessarily that intuitive, and then we'll show you the massive hack that lets you get on with your work. I've got this lovely function that's going to do some trolling of a certain length, and we're requiring in LeftPad because I've heard it's a cool library, very reliable. And TypeScript is really unhappy about all of this. So the first thing it's unhappy about is that require and module exports don't exist in TypeScript. It doesn't know what they are. I don't know why they didn't include this in lib, as like lib node. That would be good, but they didn't do that. So these don't exist, but we can add them because there's a types package for node. So if you add these, then these errors go away and it's happy. The downside is that it has no idea what these are. They're just things that exist. So it's really confused about what they are. It's just ignoring them. The second thing, but I'm not going to show that yet. The second thing that it's happening is I meant to put the error in, but the error for this was cannot redeclare left pad, and that's because of one of the worst design decisions in TypeScript. So TypeScript tries to work out if you're working in a script, like a script on a web page where everything gets loaded into global scope, or in a module where everything's got isolated scope and kind of has its own little world. And it does that by checking if you have any imports or exports, and that means ES6 imports and exports, not what we've got here. So it's basically looked at this and gone, yeah, it's a global script, everything's great. And unfortunately, I've required leftpad in another file, and so it thinks there's a clash because it thinks these are global scripts, whereas really I'm actually going to compile this down into a single script to put on my web page. So what we need to do is we need to convince it that, we need to convince it that this is a module, and by doing that we're going to convert the export there into an ES6 export, at which point it's now like, this is a module, everything's fine, we've got like local scope, no collisions, it's all good. But that's probably one of the most unintuitive problems, like, things you'll encounter in TypeScript is you need to put in at least one export or import. So I wanted to have a little aside because I'm not sure if everyone's familiar with ES6 modules. So hopefully everyone's knows a little bit about like Node, Common JS, like standard modules. So in Node, like classic Node, we've got module.exports is the way you export something from a module. And it's kind of like an object that you can either set stuff on or you can just override it completely. So I've got this really useful bit of data hi, which is, if you turn it into numbers, it's a really important prime. I'm just exporting that directly. And then I can require that in, assuming my module's called hello, and I just say require, and I get hello, and that would be my string hi. In ES6, they kind of change this, so there's no way to export the whole namespace, the whole of that exports thing. There's no way to export that anymore. There is a way to import this, and that's because there's lots of modules that just use the old style to export, so you need to be able to import them in your new style code. So they've added this special syntax, star as. There's also this possibility of exporting a named export. So that's like the main export, and then these are sort of like sub exports that can have any names. So in CommonJS, you would just do .hello, and then you get back and you just do .hello. It's all net standard JavaScript. And in ES6, you export with curly brackets, and you say that, and you can rename it and stuff as well. That's called a named export, and you can then import that. The last one is the one that's kind of become the main one in ES6. So whereas in Node, this one's the main one you're doing. In ES6, this is kind of the main thing. So there's a default export. So that's the main thing you want to export from your module, like the core thing that your module will do. And in CommonJS, that just becomes export.default. So TypeScript uses almost exactly this system, with I think like one caveat. So TypeScript has an extra one, which is that one I said was no equivalent. They've added an equivalent in TypeScript, which is export equals, just so that you can match that, and it's kind of so that they can represent any reasonable JavaScript, I think. And as I said before, TypeScript doesn't know what any of this is. TypeScript only really supports this, so you don't get any types from requires. In fact, it doesn't even like compile it, it just sort of leaves it as is. So at a certain point, it's good to convert all of your requires into imports, into ES6 imports. And that will be better down the line for kind of more static analysis and other good things. So generally a good thing to do. Right, so a couple of common gotchas and then we'll get to the hack. So common gotchas, people often reuse variables in JavaScript. It's completely normal. But in TypeScript, it's already it's inferred a type for value, so we now can't set this. So basic fix, make another variable. Incremental structures. So this is like how you used to define classes. I'm actually curious, how many people have used this? Yeah, okay, a few. So this is how we used to define classes. So it's a constructor function, and then this will be a static method on that. So we have a cat. If we have a cat that's got a name, then we can also have this utility function that will like smush together two cats and make a new cat. Then TypeScript isn't happy because what we said was we said this is a function, and now we're saying it's a function with a thing. So it gets very upset with this. So the easiest thing to do is just to switch to ES6 classes. This is the equivalent in ES6, and TypeScript understands this a lot better and is very happy with this. There are ways to make that one compile, but they're kind of a little bit awkward, because generally once you've defined something, it's generally got to kind of, it's a bit like functional programming where you're not really meant to change stuff too much. Structurally, it's not meant to change once it's being made. Anyway, use classes. Classes are better. Right, other one. Implicit default parameters. So we talked a little bit about optionals, where you can choose to have a parameter that an argument that may or may not be necessary. This is the same thing. So we've got talk, and TypeScript's not happy because we're not giving it an argument there. We could give it the argument undefined, but we kind of want to just not type anything because it's convenient. So we just put count. Question mark, which means it's now happy with it not being present. So the talk with no arguments is totally happy. And we can also kind of simplify that again because we can use a default value for the argument, which is implicitly, well, it actually takes the optional bit away because if it was going to not exist, it now gets set to one. So this actually simplifies our type system and makes the code shorter. So here's the hack. The anytype, and actually this is like the best and worst part of TypeScript. So basically if you give something the type any, it will completely, like TypeScript will completely ignore it and anything that's derived from it. So it will just, yes, TypeScript will completely ignore it and anything's derived. So you can essentially turn off TypeScript at any point using any. And it's really good because you can just get on with what you're doing. And you can kind of go back to JavaScript land if you're tired of TypeScript or if something just makes no sense. And yeah, having this was absolutely like essential for getting it into my production code, was being able to say, no, we don't care that much. It's actually OK. So we can actually solve all of the problems that we did previously using any. So value is just any. And cat, we're going to rewrite it to be a variable that's assigned to a closure, and we're going to say type of that is any, and then TypeScript doesn't care. And we lose all of the good things that we would have. I'm going to go through four things that we can change in our TS config now that will kind of make things better. So first one is really trivial, always strict. Compiles your TypeScript with the strict mode in JavaScript, and it adds the use strict to your compiled code. It's just, if you don't know about JavaScript strict mode, go and look it up. I'm not going to explain it, it's good. Strict property initialization. So this will make sure that in your classes, your properties are assigned before they're used. Basically, either in the definition of the class or in the constructor, they have to have a variable assignment, otherwise you're not allowed to use them. Unless they're set as optional with the question mark, in which case, that's fine. Strict null checks. So TypeScript has a kind of crappy default with this, where if you can substitute null and undefined for any value, and it's kind of any type of any value, it's kind of there because JavaScript programmers are lazy and they don't want to have to check if things exist. But it's just terrible. So if you turn this on, then it's going to make you check every time that something might not exist, which is kind of what you should be doing anyway, but we never do. So when I turn this on, we're like, oh yeah, that might not even be there, and that would just crash. So if anyone knows the error, cannot, what is it? Undefined is not a function. Yes, that's one of the many things that happens when you do that. So this is good. It's going to cause some turmoil in your code base as you fix all the things, but it's fun. So we need to talk about any, because I said any is great and bad. This is more of the bad. So this is our class from earlier. Everything's nice. Probably got types. Doesn't have types. So this is what happens if you inspect and see what types things are. So at the moment, TypeScript is kind of happy to give, when it can't work out a type, it just sets it to any. And it doesn't really complain. So unless you've got this next setting enabled, it's going to let you have any for lots of situations. It's not terrible, it just means you don't know what you don't know. So there's a rule called no implicit any, and it basically means you're not allowed any of these. You'd get errors and you wouldn't be allowed to use this because you haven't said what the type is explicitly. And I'd suggest when you turn this on, the first thing you do is you spend a day going and putting any in all of those places, which seems crazy, but you then get explicit and findable references to all of your types, and you could do a grep and find out how many anys you have at a very basic level. And it's a really good first step to understanding how to kind of improve your types and where they need to be improved. So yes, turn that on, do that, reserve a day for it. Right, the other problem you'll have with no implicit any is when you turn it on, all of your modules that don't have types will suddenly fail. And weirdly, there's nothing online about how to do this. So this is what I did. Might be right. Basically, in TS config, there is a type roots thing you can set. It's normally set to node modules at types, which means any at types you pull in will get loaded automatically. I've added types to it as my own local folder. And then I made a file in that folder which declares some modules. So these modules, they didn't have a types repository for them. So what I've done is I've declared them, but because I've declared them without a body, it's basically defined them as having any. They're just anys. So TypeScript will ignore these so that I can keep using them without the compiler failing. And again, it gives you an explicit list of the things you don't know, so you can come back later and improve that. And that's actually been useful. I've been some stuff I've looked at and gone, oh, can I write the types for that? Maybe I can. We'll get to that in a second. So this is full typing. So most of what we've come up to now is relatively straightforward. Most of the rest of using TypeScript is gradually working towards building types into your thing. You can kind of do this as slowly or as quickly as you want, but this is kind of the ultimate goal, is to have full typing, to have no NEs or minimal NEs, and have everything kind of all linked up and consistent. So I'm just going to go through a couple of like the sort of the final things you can do to improve that. But everything else is just trying and learning and kind of going through all the stuff we've been through already. So you can write your own module declaration. So in this section, I basically stubbed them. I said, let's just have a thing, and it's just any, don't care. However, you can explicitly write them. So this is a module that I wrote the type for. It's probably fairly accurate. It doesn't cause problems. But that's the thing, it's because this is just committed in my project, it doesn't matter if it's not completely complete. And TypeScript's flexible enough that I can quite easily like add that in without it kind of complaining and kicking with us. So what we've got here is we declare a module, which is saying the module that you, so when you do import from glob git ignore, and we're going to export a function, which means that the function named glob, so if I say import curly brackets glob from glob git ignore, that's what TypeScript understands from that. And then options is an interface that I've defined, but it's only defined inside that module. So I'm not exporting it, it's not usable outside, but it's useful for this definition, mainly to make it fit on the line in the slide. But what you can do with this is you can commit it locally, or you can commit it to, so you can make a quick PR on definitely typed, which is where all the at types modules, the type definitions are stored. And there's lots of really helpful people there who will give you advice and help you like write nice things. You can also go there and like try and fix issues, because the at types modules are separate from the regular modules, they do get out of sync, there are mistakes, there are things that go wrong. So going and patching those is also a really good thing to do. Let's assume that you've now got to the point where all your types are perfect and amazing, and our whole code base is completely consistent and it's really nice. However, you're probably going to have data from external sources. And you might say, okay, well, the data from here is this type. But it might not be, because as I said earlier, TypeScript gets removed at compile time. So when you're running it, something external can pass in whatever the hell it wants. So what you're going to need to do at a certain point is validate your input. And unfortunately, you can't validate that with the TypeScript types, because they don't exist anymore. They don't exist when you're running the code. So it will become a point to validate your schema, validate your inputs against a schema which is not written in TypeScript, which is kind of annoying. You have to keep these two things in sync, and yeah, it's just, yeah. There's no good solution right now, because TypeScript is completely removed. I think they might be working on something that would do something like this, but at the moment there's nothing there. Typecasting. I'll really quickly cover on this. It's quite late. So typecasting is a way you can basically tell TypeScript that it's wrong. It's probably not wrong, you're probably wrong, but you can. So like we've got a cat interface, and then we make a thing that's definitely not a cat, because it doesn't have a name. And then we say, okay, we'll make this new cat, and we're gonna assign that the old cat, which wasn't a cat, but we're gonna say as cat. So we're basically lying to TypeScript. We're lying to ourselves more. And so we can use this to do things that aren't right, that aren't type safe. So I've not included this previously because it's just not generally a good idea. And you know, you only need one thing to grep for in your code base. You don't need to have typecasting everywhere. So like that is what happens when you typecast. Responsible typecasting. So this is kind of possible if you know what's going on. So this is the example I could found. So this is in JSX. So this is the thing where you can put the HTML in your JS. So that, whether that's a decent good idea aside, say we've got some HTML in here. So we've got an input element, and then an on-click event, and that has an event that comes from it that's got some kind of target. But TypeScript doesn't know what kind of element will come from that. I know what kind of element will come from that because I just wrote input. So I know it's an input element. So the only way for me to access the value from that input element, which is the value from the form, is to do a typecast here. So that's kind of okay. If you know what's going on and it's kind of tractable, then it's not terrible. And it means you can have more specific types, because otherwise I'd have to sort of cast to any and not really know what's going on. Right, the only other thing I want to do is just mention, really briefly mention TS Node. So TS Node is an awesome project that you install it globally, it gives you a function called TS Node, a command called TS Node, and you can run TypeScript as if it's just JavaScript for Node, for like command line scripts and such. So you don't have to mess about with like going through compile stuff. TS Node will just like compile it and run it, which now means that all of our scripts in my team are now written in TypeScript, which is nice, because if you're using TypeScript, you kind of want everything to be in TypeScript. And yeah, that's it.